10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Good morning and welcome to the Horror Den, all horror peeps. So today is day 5, the final day of the Portland Horror Film Festival. Today is a split shift. We are skipping out on the morning shift because we have one, we read the schedule wrong. We thought everything was going to be in the evening. So we made plans for a brunch without realizing that there were going to be a second matinee block for Sunday. So we kind of like screwed that up. So we are missing the first morning of shorts. So like I said, because of my space cadetness, we ended up missing day 5's morning block of shorts. So I ended up getting a pass, and I'm super happy that I did, because those shorts on day 5 morning matinee show was nothing less than phenomenal, you guys. I cannot wait to share these movies with you. So first up was The Bumper, and it was a super cute love story. This girl calls this guy and she's like, hey, do you love me? And he's like, of course, you have my heart. And then we see his actual heart in a box of ice, and she takes an ice cube and puts it in her drink to chill her gin. And that was the bumper that kicked off that matinee showing. The movie that followed after that is called An Ordinary Family. And this is another zombie movie. Another zombie movie that made me question my commitment to being a zombie fan, because it was so out the box. And this movie had me in tears. So this movie is about a boy who is living at home with his parents in China. And it's in the middle of at first everything is normal, but as the course of the movie goes on, there's a zombie apocalypse. And the way that this movie is filmed really shows the dynamic of the traditional Eastern Asian family, where the family unit is above everything else, and all of the problems that happen within the family stay within the family. So when the movie first opens up, our hero is living with it at home because it's convenient. He's 23 years old, but he gets a call from a buddy, and he's like, hey, my roommate just left. Why don't you move in with me? And he's like, I gotta talk to my mom about it. But he doesn't get a chance, because that's when the apocalypse breaks out. And you can tell that this woman has lived her whole entire life for her son. Like, her identity is being a wife and a mother. So when there is the subtle suggestion that he wants to move out, it is met with like full force resistance, but not in like a bad way, but kind of like in a guilt-tripping way, right? And so the dad ends up getting infected, and he's tearing up the house, and he's trying to do what zombies do, and the boy is trying to protect his mom. And he wrangles his father away from his mother, and as he's getting ready to bite him, he's like, remember how he treated you, please hit him, just remember the way that he treated you. And she hit him lightly, not really to do any damage, but it was enough to get him off of her son, and they were able to put him into the bathroom. And so he gets out of the bathroom, chasing them around the house again. Unfortunately, this father is having a hard time managing the levels in which he's drinking, so he's struggling with addiction. And so as he's lunging for his family, a liquor bottle gets knocked over, and his addiction to alcohol overrides his need for brains. And so the boy is so angry when he sees his father's like this, because he's like, just like always, addicted to alcohol. So they use alcohol to lure him into the bathroom, not the bathroom, one of the rooms, and they lock him in there. And so now they have a zombie in the bathroom. The whole country's going to hell in a handbasket, and he's trying to figure out how to save his family. And so he's telling his mom, you know, I gotta go outside. We gotta figure this out. There's gotta be hope outside. And she's like, you can't leave me. He's like, okay, I'll come with me. And they get all dressed up for to fight off the zombies. The father gets loose, and again, they have to put him back into containment. And while that happens, you know, he puts his father back in the room, and he's like, you know what? I'm going to leave, and I'm going to go get help. But because her identity is so wrapped up in her son and her husband, what she does is she lets her husband out. And he is, like, on the verge of trying to bite her. And the son is like, please, I'll do anything. I won't leave. Just, we've got to get him back into the room. And it was a ruse. So the mother knew that he was going to say that. She just needed him to say it out loud because your word is your bond. And the minute he said that, she gave her husband a bottle of alcohol. And the son realized that he had been tricked. Just to see the family dynamic within this type of environment where the whole entire hell is falling apart, but they can't be bothered with that because of the dynamic of their family, was just really incredible to see. I was crying my eyes out because in the end, the mom forced the boy to leave. She's like, you know what? You were right. You said Hope's outside. You got to go get help. And he was like, I can't do this. But she had, what happened was, he was going to really hurt his father. And so what she did, the mom ran to her husband and hugged him. And of course she got bit. And so this changes everything for this boy. He's not a boy. He's a young man. But now both his parents are getting ready to be zombies. And so he's trying to convince his mom that, you know, there's still time. You know, she hasn't turned yet. They can still go get help. She locked herself in the bathroom. And she's forcing him to leave. And he's just like so incredibly alone now because he doesn't know what to do, because not only is his mother's identity wrapped up around her son, he really doesn't know how to function as an adult because his mother was doing every single thing for him. And so when she was on the other side of the bathroom wall, in the bathroom, she was telling him where his coat was and where the blankets were. And it was just incredible to see how codependent this family was on each other. So he does go out, and when he's in the building, he runs into other zombies and other families who are keeping their zombies in the house and not airing the family's dirty laundry. So he goes into a house of another boy, a young boy. He was going to attack the boy's mom because she's a zombie, but the boy like jumped in front of him and his mother. The mother didn't bite him. She was just happy that her son was there. And the older boy was like, you know, we're in the same boat. My parents are sick too. You know, I gotta try and go get help. So he goes out. He's listening to the radio. He goes to the emergency muster station. They check him out, and there's a form that says, where are your parents? And as he's like looking at the form, there's a whole paramilitary troop going to purge the city of the infected, and he decides that this is probably not a good idea. He doesn't want his family to be slaughtered, even though they're not his parents anymore. It's this whole notion of once you leave home, you can never go back again. I'm getting emotional again. So anyway, he decides to take the emergency food, and he goes back to the building, and he's distributing food to the homes that he knows people are keeping their dirty laundries inside. And when he gets back home, both of his parents are loose. And so he realizes that the only thing that his mother is addicted to is him. So the minute he comes into the house, he's afraid that she's gonna bite him. But what she does is she just hugs him. She just lays her head against his chest, and she's fine. And so he has to wrangle some alcohol to give to his dad so that he can be subdued, all the while his mother clinging to him. There's like a scene where he's like siphoning alcohol, he's mixing it with water so that they can keep his dad contained even longer, and she's like basically over his back like a backpack. And at the end of the movie, it's just them and their family unit, and it's like, it's kind of like he's not caring for zombies, but he's caring for his elder parents. This movie fucked me up in like the best way possible. It was so good. It was so good. It's getting 5 stars. Like, these directors, like, it was like they heard me say I'm not a zombie fan, and they're like, hold my brains, because, like, so far, all the zombie movies I've seen in this festival have really just, like, kicked me in the chin, and I appreciate that. So the next short is a movie called Posted No Hunting, and this is an animated, it's a clay stop motion film. It's a very short film, so we are watching this film through the lens of an animal cam. I'm not sure what those are called, but, like, you know, when nature conservatives, like, post camera so they can watch the wildlife, we're watching this movie through that type of a camera. So the first thing we see is a deer walk into view, and he's standing up below the Post-it No Hunting. And then we hear a gunshot from a hunter, and then we see the deer being dragged away. And so then the hunter comes into frame, and she's like, I don't see anything, like, it's not here, because she knows she shot the deer. But then she hears something in the distance, and she breaks one of the rules, and she goes to investigate to her own demise. And so it's a reason why they're not supposed to be hunting there. It's a super short movie. It was super fun. Her partner, her hunting partner, I really hope he made it out of there, but I don't think that he did. This movie is absolutely getting 4 stars. It was just so fun. The next movie is called Plantain, and it was so incredible. So this movie centers around, I'm gonna call her a bruja, because she is obviously very spiritual. She is basically telling us about how it opens up. She's meditating in the room of plants, and she's explaining, you know, plants take care of us just by breathing. And so she's somewhat of a like a conservationist. Like, she has her own plants, and she's got her own garden, and sometimes she's cleaning up in the neighborhood. But there's just one guy in particular who doesn't seem to understand how important taking care of Earth is, and she makes it a point to make sure that he understands clearly how important it is. It is so good. It's just, it reminds me, this woman reminds me of, like, some of my aunts in my family who are very spiritual, who are very connected to the Earth and connected with nature, and will walk around in the forest barefoot so that they can ground themselves. I am a germaphobe, so I'm not going to be doing anything like that. But, like, it was that energy, that, like, divine feminine energy, but not like what's sold to us over the counter, but true divine feminine energy, the type that's absolutely brutal and vicious and a force to be reckoned with. This movie was so good. It is getting 5 out of 5 stars. Plantain. So the next movie is called Infected Hearts. This movie I could not finish watching because I'm entomophobic. And for those of you guys who don't know what that is, I have an acute, severe fear of all bugs. And it's bad because I have put myself and those people and others around me in much more danger in trying to escape from a bug than simply, like, being still. But because of my acute fear, there's no way that I can do that. So because this movie is called Infected Hearts, and it does have a main character as a spider, it was one that I could not finish. So I didn't finish it, so of course I can't judge it. But from what I saw, it is it seems like it is a COVID movie, because they are being quarantined indoors. It's a black and white movie. It is a same-sex couple, but because of my phobia, I couldn't finish it. The next movie is frightening because of its relevance, and it's called You Will See Us. So this movie is it opens up on a guy doing a blogger, like, you know, a man in the blogosphere, and he's talking to other men such as himself who feel like women should be entitled. They feel like they should be entitled to women's bodies, because he's saying men cannot procreate without women, but we're not entitled to their bodies. So he's like, suggesting that they are going to take back the night, and if the women won't submit, they're just going to force the issue. And so these guys are walking around with antler horns painted on their forehead. And our main character is an Uber driver. She's watching this podcast, and she's like extremely unsettled about it, especially kind of like with what our current threat. So I'm in the United States, and our State Department said that one of the biggest threats to our country, our domestic security, is from within, and it's from men who feel the same way that these men in this movie feel, that they feel like they are entitled to a woman's body because they're not very nice people, they're not dating, they're kind of like incels who are like feeding each other's fuel on the internet. But in this movie, they take it outside, kind of like the Proud Boys and kind of like all those people who storm the Capitol. It's absolutely terrifying. And so this woman is an Uber driver. She picks up her fare, and this, where he's going, is in the middle of nowhere. So at, you know, right away she's uncomfortable. The conversation, he's trying to be like, he's trying to like spark up a conversation, but he's socially awkward, so he's not getting the response from her that he wants. And once they get out into the middle of nowhere is when this movie takes a turn for the worst, because he was setting her up. And I do believe this movie might be on Altar, so I don't want to like give you guys too much of it. I know it's making the circuit for the film festivals, but this movie might be on Altar. It's called You Will See Us, and it's absolutely terrifying. This short is getting 5 stars. So the next one up is called Tapehead, and this guy is a VHS enthusiast. Are you all right? Yeah. He goes to conventions, so it's like kind of like a mockumentary where they're following him around conventions. He's going to yard sales, and he's just like collecting all these VHSs, and he's saying that it has an authenticity that you just cannot get in Blu-ray DVDs. And so we follow him through his like search for VHSs, and we see some of the things that he's willing to do to get them. This is a comedic movie. His love for VHS tapes doesn't end in the end, but it was a super fun movie, and it's getting 3.5 stars. Okay, so this movie that I'm gonna talk to you guys about really made me mad, and I did not feel sorry for how this woman ended up. So we have this cute little girl who is going on a date with a guy she's been seeing for a while, and this is the first time that she's going to be going to his house. So she gets there, things get hot and heavy, and she tries to turn off the lights, but he has rigged all the lights in his house with these little strips that go underneath the light switch that prevent them from being turned off. And she's like, dude, what's going on? And so he explains to her that when he was little, they went camping. He saw something in the darkness. And he said that ever since then, this presence has always been with him. And so to keep it at bay, he never turns the light off. And he was explaining to her that he dimmed the lights for her because normally his house is even more brighter than it was, and so he flipped the switch and it was like super bright, like a surgery room, like how bright it is when you get, you know, rolled into surgery. It's super, super bright. And so he was like, I understand if this is not what you're like comfortable with, but this is I can't have the lights off, because if I do turn them off, they're gonna get me. And so she's like, it's okay, I can stay here till you fall asleep. And he's very grateful. He gives her some, those eye masks. They both have them, and he falls asleep. She doesn't, because it's, you know, the lights are on. But when she's leaving, she picks up the remote and turns the lights off. And as she's leaving, she's like, it's time for you to grow up. Now, at this point in the movie, I was seething. I was seething because I have had my fear turned against me as a form of a joke or just straight cruelty. And those people were immediately cut out of my life. Those people who have used my fear against me or as a joke, I could see them on fire and I wouldn't even spit on them. How dare you? And so how dare she, after he confided in her what was going on, that she decides that it's time for him to grow up. I don't think anyone else has a right to dictate how other people handle their fears. Like, I have a very small dog. Well, she thinks she's big, but I have a fox rat terrier. So she is 15 pounds and she is bred to catch vermin, right? And so there have been times when we've been out and about, she's small, where people have expressed their fear of dogs. And what do? I don't say, oh, she's little. No. I pick her up and give them wide berth so that they can move about and not be like triggered into a state of being traumatized and terrorized because of someone who's fucking selfish and inconsiderate. This is what this girl does in the movie. And as she's going downstairs, she starts hearing things in his apartment. And when she goes back into that fucking apartment and turns on the lights, she sees that he was fucking telling the truth. And what happens after that, she deserved everything that happened, because are you fucking kidding me? This movie fucking made me mad. I don't feel sorry for her at all. 5 stars. Had me all emotional. Okay, so the next movie we get is another zombie movie. It's called The Caregiver. So this is another mockumentary. So there's a guy that comes to this girl's house, this young woman's house, and he's making a documentary on what it's like to be a caregiver to your aging parents. And in the during the interview, he hears like thumping in the back room, and she goes from being very caring to like very cross and screaming at the person in the room that it's not time. You know, he has to wait until the interview is over, and the interviewer is like, hey, if you need me to, we can take a break. And she's like, no, that's fine. And so then her dad finally, it sounds like he fell out of the bed and he opened the door. And when the interviewer turned to see her dad, we realize it's a zombie. And so she kills him and feeds her father. And that was just like a really interesting take on the whole zombie, caring for a zombie. I have to like tell you guys a story. So the biggest, hugest fight that me and my siblings got into, where they ganged up on me and then told on me and then I ended up getting in trouble, was me and my brother were watching some like, you know, B-rated zombie movie, and I told him, if I ever got bit by a zombie, that you need to kill me. And he said, I wouldn't kill you. I would put you in the closet until the army could come and save you. Okay. No, little brother, that's not how this works. You have to kill me. I'm telling you now, if I get bit by a zombie, you have to kill me. It caused an argument. He went to our sister, who came back to defend him, and the argument became heated to the point where my mom was like, what the hell are you guys doing? And so then they told on me. And then my mom was like, how dare you want to die? We would put you in the closet until the army came. And I'm like, I was just like so angry. They were so against me, and I think they would still not put a bullet in my head. So I can kind of get where this movie, The Caregiver, The Boy in the Box, An Ordinary Family, I can see how these situations would occur, because my own brother told me that if I got bit by a zombie, he would like keep me alive for as long as he could until the army could come and fix me. No, but I just don't understand how even now he knows that if he takes a zombie to the army, they will do what I asked him to do in the beginning. So like, whatever. Anyway, that was a little bit of a tangent, but this movie was really good. It's getting 3 stars because it is a bit gory. It does like fall back on the traditional tropes of the zombie movie, and it becomes a little bit gory. So 3.5 stars. So this next movie after Caregiver is called The Sickness of Perfection. Now, the very first thing that I want to talk to you guys about this movie is the color. The color in this movie is the way, like, the color scheme of this movie is just fucking, it's breathtaking. And the girl who is the embodiment of perfection is actually that. I don't know where they found this girl from. She is drop dead gorgeous. So I'm not sure. I don't think that she's working with a client. I think they're in a relationship, because there's no way a photographer would talk to a client like this. So I do believe that this is a same-sex couple. They're like in a relationship, because you only have the ones you love, right? And so this photographer has got this drop-dead gorgeous girlfriend, and she is putting her in these positions, and when she tells her, "You look perfect," she gets sick. And so the movie goes on and on with, like, her, like, taking pictures of, like, there's, like, flashes going off, and there's, like, this gorgeous girl posing, but you can see as the movie goes on and on, she starts to get more and more ill. And then there's a pivotal point in the movie where there's nothing perfect in what she's doing. It's absolutely animalistic. And then the tables turn. And so when they turn, is what makes this movie, this very dark movie, become even more darker. I really appreciated this movie a lot. It is gorgeous to watch. The main character, the object of the embodiment of perfection, is exactly that. And watching how things got switched on its heel was pretty amazing. I mean, these are shorts, right? It's dang amazing. Fucking amazing. 5 stars. So the next movie is called Stuck. This movie really made me mad, because I don't like watching horror movies where people are doing stupid stuff. Like, once you start doing stupid stuff, I check out. But because I'm reviewing this movie, I stuck with it. Thank God it was only a short. So we have this woman who has moved into a new apartment. She goes upstairs and finds a box. And I want to tell you guys right now, I am tired of people opening boxes that look like this. Like, they're locked like this for a reason. So she tries to open the box and she can't. So she goes downstairs to get something to open the box with. As she turns her back to the box opens, just a crack. And so she goes and she finds something to open the box with. And as she opens it, she's looking down into the abyss, right? So she's like, nope, I'm done with this. This is crazy. So she runs down the stairs, and what was released was a demon. Like, it's coming up the stairs as she's running down. Now, the first stupid thing that she did was open the box, right? That was the first stupid thing. The second thing that kind of, like, yanked me out of this story, out of, like, being absolutely buying it hook, line, and sinker, is when this demon bit her. So he, with all these, like, sharp teeth, bit her in her thigh and ripped out a chunk of flesh. And the way she reacted was as if nothing more happened than being nicked with a puppy she was playing with. Like, she was, like, you know what I mean? She should have been screaming to the top of her lungs. But, like, she was like, oh, like, really? This is a demon. He ripped out a piece of your flesh, and this is the reaction? I'm not buying it. So she runs back upstairs into the attic, and this girl climbs her fucking ass in the box. Like, why would you do that? One, you should have never opened the box in the first place, but knowing what came out of it, why the fuck would you climb in the box to hide from it? That's where it lives. And of course she didn't get away. So like it was just like, it just didn't sell it. So this movie did have a lot of potential. I was kind of disappointed because of what was going on in the movie. It just wasn't believable. So it's getting 3.5 stars. The last movie in this block fucked me all the way up. So after I got done watching it, I hugged my dog and we went outside for a walk. And then I gave her a puppuccino because I like when she's happy. So this movie is called Safe and Sound. So there's a babysitter. It's really interesting how babysitters are teenagers, but they are put in very adult situations because they are responsible for a child that could be like much younger than they are. And so she's a teen. The kid is like, that she's babysitting, it's got to be like 7 or 8, right? And they're in a smart home. So They are safe and sound. All of the locks, everything that's supposed to be locked in this house is locked, and the alarm is armed. So what happens after she puts the kid to bed, she starts hearing breaches within the house. Like, the bathroom window is open, and she's like, what? And so she's running around the house listening to all these breaches, trying to figure out what to do. And then we see what's breaching this residence. And you guys, it's just, what makes it terrifying is this is a child, right? This is a child trying to protect another child against an extra dimensional demon. And unfortunately for this kid, this movie just like gave me chills. Like, I really enjoyed the fuck out of this movie. Safe and Sound is absolutely getting 5 stars. It's just, it was insane. It was insane. And it was the perfect block of movies to set us up for the feature called Nati Morti, which I will be reviewing as a live action review right here because of my space cadetness. But stay tuned for that, because that's coming up next, because that was the movie that followed these blocks of shorts. Okay. What in the whole ass fuck? Try and run. Can you run? Fuck, it's too late. I'm sorry, what the fuck? Where did she fucking stab him at? You're not gonna do this, right? You are gonna fucking do this. Okay. Oh my fucking god. Okay, okay. Okay, this is the whole blood and skin and no fucking gloves is gonna bother me. Just go get in your fucking truck and go home. You don't want what she's doing. Excuse me, you killed a woman, so you don't get to be indignant. No, she's not gonna fucking untie you. Ha 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 ha! You are in no position to make any type of fucking demands. Oh, the audacity for me. You get what you fucking give. How does she know his name? Oh, okay. He is so fucking smug. Call him Antonio. You really have... Exactly. Yep, yep. This fucking guy. What do you mean catch us? You killed her. She didn't. Yeah, the fuck she will. This fucking guy is getting on my fucking nerves. Leave him on the fucking floor. Leave him there. But this is something you're used to. You fucking do taxidermy. You pick up dead shit all the time. You know how decay works. And I am tired of you not using gloves. Come on, Laura, do not let him get away. He doesn't deserve it. You know what? He needs to be on your embalming table at this point. Yep. Like a fucking dog. Because that's what he fucking is. This man is not well. Okay, what the fuck's going on, Antonio? So, really? Right where you are. Right. Nobody trusts him. Nope. You deserve no fucking mercy. None. You. How many times did she beg you to let her go? What is that? Oh my God! Are we for real? Ugh, we're for real. Jesus H fucking Christ. But is he just free to be roaming around? Let's find out. He's not chained? Yeah, did you really think that she was not going to be prepared for you to come upstairs with that in your hand? No, she didn't. Absolutely. Yep. You really think that you're in the position to make demands? Right, right. She's like, who the fuck do you think you are? Sit your fat ass down and eat dinner. Yeah, we do think you're a fucking total ass. I wouldn't fucking feed him shit. You know what? He is... I hate this guy. The machismo of this guy is really fucking over the top. Like, are you fucking serious? Do you really realize this... the situation that you're in? It means she's fucking busy. Okay, first of all, we need to not show up at people's house unannounced. Which house needs to be sold? And who is this? Her sister? You have a body to sort out. She has nothing to do with that. And so are you. What the fuck is wrong with these two people? That's why she was gonna use the hacksaw, because you don't know what the fuck you're doing. See? Use the saw. This guy, okay. Apparently he's never, ever, ever in his whole entire life saw a horror movie, because clearly you cut up a body with a fucking saw. He's just making a fucking mess. Just a brute fucking mess. Again with no gloves. I guess neither one of them knows what the term forensic science means. They're on your way to your house, so you might want to fucking pick up the phone. And where the fuck is she supposed to live if they sell that house? No, she's got a fucking sister who's not fucking... Nope. Tell him about your sister, because she's gonna knock on the fucking door and he's gonna freak the fuck out. Her sister. Oh, that's why she wants to sell the fucking house. Okay. I would not fucking, that's her dad's house. That's her childhood home. Are you fucking kidding? What in the we found strange love in the hopeless playlist is this? Does he have Stockholm Syndrome? Okay. No, he's not gonna leave. He is staying voluntarily. Okay. Which means the second wife is walking into her last tomorrow. Okay. Here we go. This movie is fucking crazy. And not only did you not, you just walked in. Luna. Yeah, I wouldn't sell that house. Luna. She's the heir. Like, here we go with these two. That's her fucking house. You're never leaving. Don't sign them. Yep, that's her dad's house. That's her fucking house. These two fucking people. Don't let him fucking get away. You guys are gonna do this shit right. That was the very last thing you should have said to her. Okay, well, you just sealed your fucking fate. If your situation wasn't bad enough, you just made it fucking worse. What do you mean? What do you mean? Did you kill him? Did she kill her? Did she kill this girl's dad? This doesn't look good for you, Sensei. We already knew they weren't fucking leaving that house, so. I'm not understanding the whole no gloves thing. Like, you're putting your hands all the way up to your fucking elbows in a human body with no gloves. Like, what? Oh, God. again, though, you should be wearing gloves handling shit like that. Maybe she can teach him how to be more efficient, because why? Go do what he fucking said! You're not gonna fucking make it. Wait, okay, hold on. I am torn. How do I feel right now? The fucking postal guy. Okay, well, damn. Who the fuck is calling me? I'm busy. Just skip her. Just skip her. Just go home to your family. She hasn't been answering the door. Just don't go there. Nope, we're going right over to Luna's house. Even though I told you not to. Luna, did you move the car like he told you to do? Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Hurry up, here he comes. If she doesn't answer the phone, don't go to her house, okay? Just let it be. If she needs to ship that shit, she can go to the post office herself. What's happening? Where's everybody at? There's too much fucking movement. I don't know what's going on. Luna? Okay, where's Luna? And where's the car? Did we lock the gate? Like, oh my god, come on! What? Where? What? Okay, you guys are fucked. Like, I don't understand. But you know what? Because you don't want to wear fucking gloves, guess whose fucking prints are on that goddamn car? Yours. You're gonna get caught. You guys aren't getting away with this. Like, how is this gonna work out? And Luna, how are you gonna go all the way home in bloody clothes? You're just gonna run down the road? The postal guy is gonna see you. This is stressing me out. Antonio, come on. You're almost there. Am I rooting for them? I am. I want them to make it. I'm rooting for these guys now. So, please. Oh my god, please don't be seen, Luna. The postal guy is gonna be right around that goddamn corner. Here he comes. I told you! Okay, now what? Oh, she's covered from head to toe in blood. Don't fucking knock on that door, just go home. Just go home. Oh. Are we kidding? Okay, well. Fucking hell. This is why people need to mind their own goddamn business, okay? gonna have to die. Luna, where the fuck are you at? Kill him! You guys are gonna have to fucking kill him! Yep. Tony can't catch him because he's sick. You're gonna have to catch him. Where are you going, Julius? Why didn't you just go out the front door? You're dumb. Perfect. This is the perfect place for you to be killed. See? Told you. Now, what are we gonna do about the fucking mail van? Wait, what's going on? Luna, help him! Luna. Okay. Luna, do something! In the whole ass fuck. Dudes, oh my fucking God. So, basically, this is a fucking love story. Oh my God, you guys. Let's get into this. Okay, Nati Morti. So the plot of this movie is about a young embalmer who is super passionate about all things death. And one day when she's in the woods, she finds a dead woman and a guy who is almost dead. He's barely breathing. And that day changes the rest of her life forever. OM fucking G. So, like I said, she's not just an embalmer, she's a taxidermist. And one day she's like, you know, foraging for the woods, through the woods to find small animals that have, you know, died so that she can take them home and, clean them all out and use them for her taxidermy hobby. She comes across a crime scene, right? And so she finds a woman who's dead and a guy who's barely breathing. And like anyone with that would happen to like stumble upon a scene like that, she's freaking out. So she checks the pulse of the woman, nothing. She checks the pulse of the guy, he's still breathing. So she drags him back to the car and it seems like she's gonna take him to the hospital like any normal person would. But as she's driving away, she remembered that she left her her scavenging bag with her animal that she had found for her next project. So when she goes back to get her bag and it's next to the dead woman, you can see the gears in Laura's head start to turn. So now we went to a concerned Good Samaritan to something quite altogether different. So she gathers the body, she prepares it the way that she did the bird, wraps it up in plastic, and she takes everybody home. And so she ties up, the guy, his name is Antonio. She ties him up, and we find out that Antonio, the reason that they were out in the middle of nowhere was Antonio was trying to kill this woman that he had raped. And he actually did kill her, but she didn't go down without a fight. And so she hurt him really bad. And that's how Luna was able to take him home and make him her captive. And so he's in so much pain. He's kind of like in and out of consciousness. And so she tied him to a chair and she's tending to his wounds. And she's like a taxidermist, right? So she's sewing up his wounds like any doctor would do stitches. And so a couple of days go by and Antonio is starting to regain consciousness and he becomes belligerent and smug. And I, from that moment, did not like him. Like, I didn't like him when I found out what he had done to this woman. And I didn't like him after he was like belittling Luna, like demanding that she, you know, submit to his fucking machismo and do what, you know, he was telling her to do. But like, he just didn't really understand the circumstances that he was in. And I don't really think that he understood how dangerous she had the potential to be. So they're fighting back and forth. Luna is kind of over it. And he in the midst of a tantrum, knocked his chair over. He sat up in a chair. And so he's begging Luna to help her. Luna's like, you know, this is the last time I'm going to help you. But when she goes to sit up the chair, we find out he had got loose from his ties, like the rope that had tied him to the chair. So there's a struggle. Of course, Luna gets the upper hand. And what she does is she chains him to the gurney that the dead body is on. And she's like, you wanted her, now you can have her. So for the next 2 days, I need to back up a little bit. So when he was free and they were struggling, instead of trying to escape like any victim would, he actually went to the body and started hugging this dead corpse. And so that's when Luna decided, okay, you want her? Fine. And she chained him to that gurney and she's like, I'm never gonna help you again. You could fucking die there. And so time goes on and now Antonio is really beginning to understand that he's not in a really good place and he does need to be obedient if he wants to get out of this on the other side. And so he changes his tune. Like there's a scene where he's like, okay, I'm sorry, please untie me out to the bathroom. She's like, nope, I don't trust you. You can go to the bathroom right there, which he does. And then he's, because of his injury, it's infected. So he's having these wild ass fever induced dreams. And in one dream, he's eating the dead body. But when we realize that he's not dreaming, he did rip a piece of flesh off that corpse and chewed it up and swallowed it. And for some reason, that was the turning point for Luna. So after he ate her flesh, she unties him from the gurney, lays him down, cleans his wounds, washes his face, gives him some antibiotic, and covered him up, and he's completely unchained, right? So in the morning, when he wakes up and he's a little bit stronger, he thinks he's just gonna go upstairs and kill Luna. And of course, again, he doesn't realize the predicament that he's in. So when he gets upstairs, he finds out that she prepared breakfast. There's steak, water, and wine on the table. And he's like, I'm going to kill you. And she's rolling her eyes. And she's like, really? You need me because there's a body downstairs. And if you go to the hospital the way you look now, you're going to have to answer some questions. And so he's like, I'm not going to eat the meat. It's poison. And so she takes a bite of the meat. And she's like, so you can either wait till the poison kicks in or you can fucking eat breakfast, basically. And so during breakfast, he's still being a fucking ass. And he's like asking her, you know, he's like, what do you want from me? Like, why didn't you call the police from the very beginning? And then this is when we find out that some little girls wait forever for the knight in shining armor to come and rescue them. But what Luna has been waiting for was not the beauty, but the beast. And Antonio is an embodiment of a beast. He's big, he's brute, he's violent, he's all of that. He is not a good man. And when she sees him for all that he is and tells him that she wants him in all the ways that he is at that moment, things start to change, right? Like he's like, is this even true? Like, are you fucking with me? No, she wasn't. So then he tests her. He's like, okay, well, what are you going to do about the body downstairs? And so as they go downstairs to get rid of the body, she told him that the body was his canvas and he was the painter and she was going to photograph his art. And during this scene, when they are watching each other in this very gruesome scene, because he's chopping up a body, he's not using a saw, he's like chopping it up, it's messy, it's brutal, there's blood everywhere, she's in awe of him, she is just standing there renovated, taking pictures, and they make eye contact. And in this fucked up moment, these two people fall in love. And what have been a better soundtrack than what was playing at the time would have been that song from Rihanna, We Find Love in the Strangest Places. Is that right? You guys know the song I'm talking about. And so these two people fall in love. And because I am a hopeless romantic, I stopped hating Antonio and started rooting for the both of them as a couple. Okay, so they've got rid of the body. He's taking a shower. He's starting to trust her. Things are like moving along in this little relationship that they have. There's absolutely trust now. We find out that the house that she's living in is her late father's. And we get to meet her stepmom because apparently after the death of her father, she wants to sell that house. She wants to sell Luna's family home so that they can split the profits. And Luna, for the longest time, had been ignoring her phone calls. And so this woman, Cincy, I think I'm saying that wrong. I know that I am. But she is so frustrated that Luna's not answering her phone calls that she decides to show up on her doorstep unannounced. Huge fucking mistake. And so after the body is disposed of and Antonio gets out of the shower, he's thinking that this is going to be his happily ever after. And so he's like, you know, looking at her lovingly and he's like expecting that affection to be returned, but she's agitated and she's like, hey, if you want to leave, now's the time for you to go because my stepmom's coming. And he's confused. He's like, what do you mean leave? And so like, I wasn't sure if he was like 100% into this or if he was like suffering from mild Stockholm syndrome, because we have to remember at the very first of the movie, for like half of the movie, he was her captive. And so she goes out onto this gorgeous terrace and she's like, you know what? She's coming here. They're going to ruin everything. This is fucked up. You have to leave. And he decides, he's like, you know what? I'm your beast. If we need to take care of some things, like, let me know what to do. And you guys, you know what? I want to keep talking more and more, but I don't want to give spoilers away. But then this is a festival film, so I don't know if it's going to be available to be streamed. But even if it is, everything that I'm telling you is not going to take away from the enjoyment of this film, because like there's so much to unpack in this film. It's just like, it's fucking crazy. My suspension of disbelief on a scale of 1 to 5 is 5, because from the very moment that Antonio woke up into that basement in her, basically it's like a giant morgue / taxidermy lab, right? He's being a dick and he's like really like all of that machismo, even though he's in a place of submission, pissed me off right away. I didn't like him right away. He sucked me right in with the character that you love to hate. But as the movie progressed and they became moving as one unit, as a couple, after they fell in love, then I was rooting for the both of them. I was just like, talk about a plot twist. Like I just, nothing in this movie, nothing that was done, nothing that was said, nothing that was displayed snatched me out of my suspension of disbelief. I was with this movie from the minute he woke up in the chair all the way till end scene. So 5 stars all the way. The scariness factor. Now, this movie is not so much scary as it is stressful. So as far as being scary in the traditional sense in the way, it is not. So it is getting 0 stars, but not in a bad way. This movie is fucking stressful as fuck because the way that it unfolds itself and the pacing and it starts off pretty quick and then in the middle, it puts everything in high gear and then drives us off a cliff, like right off the cliff. They don't care, whoever, this director does not care about their fans' emotional well-being, like not at all. Like, it's insane. It was just like super, super stressful. There are some scenes that are gory because she is a taxidermist and this guy seems to be a serial killer or knows his way around a knife and a body. So there is tons of blood, tons of gore, but as far as it being scary, it's a 0 stars, but not in a bad way. This movie isn't scary. It is absolutely stressful. Absolutely stressful. The ending is like a fucking gut punch because, like I said, I had went from hating him to loving them both as a couple, and because of everything that was going on, the stress factor, the stuff that was going on in the movie that they couldn't control, I don't think it could have ended any other way than it did. It was just it. This ending is absolutely the cherry on top of this movie. Like, it was just like, it was so good. So unpredictable plot twist after plot twist after unpredictable moment after unpredictable moment. This movie is a wild ride. If I could sum this movie up in like an elevator speech, if I could sum it up, it would be like, boy kills girl, girl saves boy, boy and girl fall in love, girl kills family for boy, and then the rest I'm not gonna tell you, because hopefully you guys will be able to see this fucking amazing movie. The ending, 5 stars. Who would like it? So, anyone who likes movies where there's a captive trying to save themselves, anyone who likes a really complex, multi-layered, really good movie that has phenomenal storytelling that makes you think, would love this movie. You know what? The thing is, this is a romantic horror movie. So if you guys are hopeless romantics like I am, you will love this movie too. For those of you guys who love gore, there's plenty of that in this for you. And for those of you who prefer a realistic ending over a happy one, just so that you can feel good, this is the movie for you as well. This movie was just really incredible, and I'm super happy that Portland Horror Film Festival was able to secure this movie so that we could watch it. Like, oh my God, you guys, it is my hope that you guys get to see it too. So you guys already know where I'm going with this, right? It's getting absolutely 5 stars. This movie like blew me away. I was not expecting the double plot twist and the way that things ended up, but it was just so good. I really hope that you guys get to see this movie. It was just amazing. Nati Morti, you guys. We will be there for the second shift. Let's talk about the movies yesterday morning. So the bumper that starts it all off was super cool. It was a film by the Portland Horror Movie Club. And their bumper was a woman who was trying to find food for her zombie. And so she runs into a Christian who was like, you know, you need to be eating the body of Christ. And she's like, you know, rolling her eyes. She's like, sure, this might work. And so she takes the crackers home to her zombie, and the zombie is upset because it's not the body of Christ, it's actually communion crackers. And then it goes into an info commercial called The Body of Jeff, which is basically like a regular dog food commercial that has organic human ingredients to feed your zombie with no artificial ingredients. That was like really cool. And again, that was put on by the Portland Horror Movie Club. I know I said that all wrong, but I'll put that up here so that you guys can find it. They were the ones who held the camera for us when I interviewed Callie. So their bumper was really, really fun. So the first short of yesterday. So yesterday was all women, all horror women, all movies, shit, all horror movies written by women. And it was an extremely emotional block. I don't think I saw one movie that two movies that I didn't cry at. The first one that kicked it off was called A Boy Who Woke Up Dead. And so this is a very small child who woke up and dug himself out of the grave and went home. And his family, of course, is terrified of him. He's like, not like he's zombie-ish. I don't think he's an actual zombie because he had a funeral. And he's thinking in his mind where he's like talking. He can hear himself talking perfectly, but when he tries to vocalize it, he's just making zombie moaning sounds, right? So he's like trying to indicate that he's hungry, and that's when he bites the cat. This is a black and white animated movie, and it's really amazing because it's told in poem form, and the person who narrated the movie has an amazing voice. And it was super sad because
they're afraid of this little boy. He is their child. They don't know what to do with him, so they end up locking him in the shed. So he is still with the family, but he is isolated from the family because he has the potential to be dangerous. And so, of course, we were bawling our eyes out after that short. So, of course, that one gets... I feel like I'm really close to the camera this morning. That one's getting 5 stars. Spaghetti Face is another short that's making the circuit rounds. I've seen this at the Crypticon Film Festival. It is so fun. So this story tells a story about three little boys who are sitting around telling scary stories. And each one is more funnier or grosser than the last. But the last story is about, it's almost like a mirror game, but this one, he has to go outside and he screams Spaghetti Face 3 times into the darkness. And like the mirror games, they are not games. They are that type of activity that you shouldn't be doing. And even though the ending isn't terribly happy, it is still fun and festive. It was just it was a really cute movie that featured all children actors. The only adult actor was the teacher in this movie. So this one was really, really fun. It's getting 3.5 stars. The next one that tore out our fucking hearts was a movie called I'll Never Be Alive Again. And so in this movie, there has been a pharmaceutical breakthrough that allows zombies to live next to us unaffected people with the use of medicine that they have to take every day and a raw food diet, like literally a raw food diet. And so as we follow this one woman who is gotten a second chance at life, we follow her, how she became a zombie and all the opportunities she lost because she was like a renowned artist who was going to get this Fulbright scholarship or her art was going to be featured in a prestigious gallery. I can't remember which one. She had like a very promising future. She was a young wife with a young child. And as she became infected, the person she killed was her child. And watching her live a second life as a zombie, feeling unworthy, and going through all the everything that was being remembered was such a hard movie to watch. And unfortunately, some of the zombies who got the second chance, something is going on with the medication where they're reverting back to their zombieism state, and she's one of the candidates in the study who is reverting back to zombieism. It was just such a super sad movie. It was just such a sad movie. I'm not like that big of a fan of a zombie movie because I'm not a gore fan, but like when zombie movies like this are like really someone really thinks outside of the box and we get to see it from this point of view and like from the little boy who woke up dead and gives a different perspective on it and really like really just like puts their heart and soul into these movies. It's just, it's incredible. And it was heart-wrenching and I was crying my eyes out. So of course, I'll Never Be Alive Again is getting 5 stars. The next movie up was a creepy little movie called Conversation with E. And so this girl is on her way to school and she sees this box in the road. She can't open it, but there's a sticky note on it that says, "Hi, E." And so she writes on there, "Hello, Emily." I can't remember if that's her name, but you guys get the gist. So she goes on about her day and she's at the library and she picks out this library book and she opens it in the middle and there's a sticky note from E. And as you can imagine, this is extremely creepy. She is looking over her shoulder at this point because she doesn't know where the sticky notes are coming from. And each note is more sinister than the last. And it has a really, really good ending because he asked a riddle and unfortunately she solves the riddle to her demise. Really good, creepy movie. This one is getting 4 stars. So the next movie that's up is also making the rounds and it is called cookie crumble. And so it takes a dark turn on what goes on when it is Girl Scout cookie season. In this movie, these Girl Scouts are everywhere. They're all over the neighborhood. They're in the, they have radio commercials. They have, they're online. They're everywhere. And just like regular Girl Scouts, these guys are absolutely enthusiastic sellers. But of course, this is a horror movie and it takes a turn for the worst. This is another movie that has a lot of children actors. I think the only, there's a handful of adults, but there's a lot of girls in this movie, as they're not Girl Scouts. They're called Chipmunks, the Chipmunks. And it's just, it's a really fun, everyone can kind of like relate to what goes on in this movie, because we've all tried to dodge Girl Scouts. We've all like been guilt tripped by Girl Scouts because they're trying to make their quota. We've all fell victim to their sell tactics and their big crocodile eye tears. Like, it was just a perfect movie of how we feel when we are inundated with Girl Scouts during the season, but they take that to another level and make it scary. And just like the first time I saw it in the Crypticon Film Festival, when my really good friend Isabella Price popped up on the screen, it was startling and surprising to see her on screen. It's just really like fun and exciting to see your friends on screen when you're watching a movie you're not expecting them to be there. Just like in the Crypticon Film Festival, this one's getting a 5. So after Cookie Crumble comes a movie called Strongbox. This is another comedic movie that is slapstick and over the top. So this movie follows a story about a guy who owes his boss $500, and he's supposed to be working overtime to pay it back. And he's working in somewhat of like a warehouse. And so he finds this old treasure chest with locks on it. Of course, you're not supposed to be opening those types of boxes. And somehow he says the right Latin words to pop open the box. And so when the box pops open, he sees a head inside and he's like, he's a black guy. So he's like, nope, hell no, I'm out of here. And the king, that's the head of the king that's in the box, he's like, I beseech you, good sir, please help me. So then there's like banter of this old king from like speaking in old English and an inner city janitor who is like acting like regular black people would act in a horror movie, but like it's comedic. So like he does owe $500. And so the head of the king is like, hey, if you help me out of this box, you can have all of this money. And it's a box full of gold. And of course, we remember this guy owes his boss $500. And so he does grab the head of the king and he says the magical words to pull him out of the box. And so he's like, now what do I do? And so the king's like, you got to take me to the sea. And you got to, he's like telling him the steps that he needs to do to set him free. So what the guy does is he like takes the crown off the king and he throws the head on the floor. He puts the crown on and he's like popping bottles in the club because he's like taking the gold out of the box. But what the king did not tell him, and of course everyone in the audience knew, that gold in the box is cursed. And at the end of the movie, of course, our unlikely hero is not popping bottles in the club. That was such a super fun movie. It seemed like between that one and Cookie Crumble was a tie between the audience favorites, and this one is absolutely getting 5 stars. The last short of that block was called The Last Christmas. This movie was off the chain. I love horror Christmas stories. You guys know that I wrote one myself called The Christmas Wish. You guys can listen to that. Yes, I'm gonna plug in my work. You guys can find that on my audiobook or in my my anthology, And They All Lived Happily Ever After. Spoiler, they don't, because I'm a horror author. But anyway, The Last Christmas, this little girl is being teased at school because she still believes in Santa Claus. And so what she's going to do is she's going to take a picture of Santa Claus to prove to her classmates that she, that he exists and that her belief in him is not to be teased. And so things go awry and she ends up killing Santa Claus. Like, he falls and like crashes into a glass table, and the glass table is like right into his forehead. And so she tries to wake up her brother to help her. And her brother's like, if this is about monsters, I'm going to hurt you. So then she goes to wake up her teenage sister, who comes down. And she is like, what in the whole ass hell has happened here? And so then we find out this little girl's not as innocent as she appears, because she's got this whole plan on how to dispose of Santa's body. And the teenage kid is like, listen, we need to wake up our parents. Like, technically, he is a trespasser. You didn't know you have the right to shoot him. It's like a crazy movie, right? And she's saying the world will understand because, you know, we didn't know Santa was real. And so then the little girl's like, I want to have friends and you want to be the junior prom queen. And she's like, that doesn't seem like the future for children who killed Santa Claus and caused the last Christmas. And so the teenage girl's like tilting her head like, wait a minute, I didn't kill Santa Claus, you did. But she's thinking about what her little sister said. And so they hatch this plan to try and kill Santa Claus. The thing is, it is actually Santa Claus. So in the midst of them going to bury him in the backyard, he comes to and he tells the girls, this is not the first time that children have tried to get proof and then end up hurting him and then trying to cover up the tracks. And so then we find out there is a naughty list and there is consequences to being on the naughty list. And this movie was super fun, over the top. Everybody was laughing and it was the perfect movie to get us ready for the feature film that really, really fucked us all up. All our peeps, we are on our way to day 5, the final day of the Portland Horror Film Festival. It's been a hell of a week. So yeah, I will get there and give you updates as we go. Okay guys, let's get into this.
Hello everyone.
Welcome to closing night. How many of you were here on opening night? Keep your hands up if you've been here every day between. Okay. How many of you are just here tonight? Oh, wow. Okay, cool. Well, welcome. You're a little late. No, you're fine. if you had to come one night, closing night is a fantastic night to come, I think. We save some of the best stuff for last. We save some of the weirdest stuff for last. We save some of the bloodiest stuff for last. Yeah. Pretty bloody tonight. But also pretty funny. We've got a lot of funny stuff for you to watch. We hope everybody likes horror comedies, right? The first feature we show is not one of those. So we're going to get started with our opening shorts. The opening shorts are also attached to our first feature, which is the Pacific Northwest premiere of The Parker Sessions, directed by Stephen King Simmons, who is with us tonight. And why don't you tell them what's coming up next?
So first of all, for any of you who don't know us, I'm Gwen Callahan, and this is Brian Callahan. We're the directors of the Portland Horror Film Festival.
I think that's the first time I've said my name, or I didn't say my name on stage, but it might be the first time my name has been said on stage.
So at least the second time.
Okay. Nice to meet you.
But anyways, thank you for joining us. We have, like he said, an amazing shorts program lined up. If you are just joining us tonight, and after these films, you're like, why did I not go to more nights at the Portland Horror Film Festival? We got you covered. Everything is still streaming online through Wednesday, July 6th. So you can go home and tomorrow queue it all up and just binge watch through the holiday, hide out from all the fireworks and crazy drivers, and just cuddle up in the dark with some more horror.
There's a lot, you know. Throughout the course of this festival, we showed over 60 short and feature films. The only thing you won't find streaming was our Thursday night theatrical exclusive of Revealer. But everything else is streaming. And even if you've seen all the films, there's tons of Q&As we did with filmmakers over Zoom. And you can watch those for free. All you need is an Eventim account. You go to portlandhorror.eventim.org. You have to find your way to our streaming festival catalog. But once you're there, you'll see all the live streams that you can watch and tons of background information on almost all the films we play.
Yeah, we did a ton of Q&As and it was really fun to talk with all the filmmakers And so we have a few filmmakers with us here tonight for, well, Stephen King Simmons will be doing Q&A after Parker Sessions. And then we also have some filmmakers after the show has gone wild to talk to.
And that's the after we take a break in the Q&A with Stephen King Simmons. Then we'll be back with the Shorts Gone Wild. I'm so excited to show these two. They're so good. So excited. They're so good. I know we've been talking about it all week. We finally reached that point. So we can't wait to show you those. And then after that set of amazing films, and it's a nice, healthy, long block of just crazy shit that you're going to love. After that, we're going to have some more filmmaker Q&As. And then we'll be finishing with our final feature of the night. Why don't you tell them about it?
It Hatched. It's an Icelandic folk horror based on a Scandinavian folklore myth of the Mara, which is that nightmare creature that we experience it as like night terrors or sleep paralysis in that form. So this is an embodiment of that, but it's a young couple moves out into the middle of nowhere in Iceland to try to open a guest house. There's a weird thing in the basement, and as we all know, that's a recipe for something weird happening. Anyway, the film, it is crazy.
It's hilarious, it's scary, and there's a reason we're playing it as our very last film of the festival.
So one last thing before we get started, I just want to thank you all for being here as patrons of horror, as supporters of independent horror. It's so important that you guys see these things in a theater with the visiting filmmakers. It's important for the filmmakers to be able to experience this with an audience as well. And most of the stuff, like some of the features will go on streaming and maybe some of the short films will be on YouTube, but really experiencing all these things with each other in our community, with an audience of people as a shared experience is so important for art, for, you know, giving us some culture about who we are in the world, and as horror fans, just being able to connect with each other in this way. I'm so happy to see you back in the theater, and I just want to thank you for joining us.
Just to build on what I know it's fun and it's bloody and groovy, and we all have a good time, but for the filmmakers, this is essential. And thank you so much for being here to watch their stuff.
Oh, and don't forget to vote for the Audience Choice Award. Those are those yellow ballots that you've all got. Rate each film, and then at the end, we'll collect them all. We tally them all up. We combine them with the votes from the streaming folks. And then you guys have picked an Audience Choice Award winner that we will announce in our Words of Video sometime next week.
That's ambitious.
Ambitious?
I was trying not to put a due date
on that. Sometime in the future.
I think we released our last one 6 months after festival. So we'll try to be a little more timely. So somewhere between a week and 6 months.
Somewhere in there. But anyways, don't forget to vote. There's ballots out there if you missed it at the front table, and there's a box to collect them all on your way out.
Awesome. Are you guys ready to watch some movies? I don't know. I think I heard mosquitoes or something in here.
What was that?
I don't know. Good. Well, here, let me try this again. Are you guys ready to watch some movies? Okay, that got through the early onset hearing loss. So, okay, let's do it then.
Stephen King Simmons, the writer and director of the Parker
Sessions. First off, I'd like to say, everyone, thank you for coming out. And second, Portland Horror Film Festival, thank you. It's a privilege. When we first started going out for the film festival circuit, we started out with Fright Fest out in the UK, and ending Parker Sessions with the Portland Horror Film Festival. It's just, it's like bookending an experience that's been happening for a year and a half. That's both been, it's just been bittersweet, you know? Especially with a film like this, so.
There's, I'm just gonna dive into, there's a lot of layers to this film, so let's, I'm gonna try to peel them a little bit, still leave a little bit of mystery, but why black and white film?
You know, Stephen Gammel, the illustrator of Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark, I first started doing short films, adapting those until the feature film of Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark came out, because it was so bad. So I was like, what am I doing with my life, you know? Even with all these views on YouTube, like, what am I doing? So I wanted to take it a step further. Honestly, I'm changing the credits at the end, and I want to do a tribute to Stephen Gammel for the black and white. I just think it's gorgeous. I think there should be more black and white films, and we're starting to see that more, like the shift. Even with Fincher recently, he came out with a feature that was completely in black and white.
For so this story of you know, the patient seeing this, is he a therapist or just like a counselor?
No, he's a counselor. So like originally I was supposed to be Parker, and even when I pitched this story to my producer, I was like, I'm Parker, and I went to see five. No. I don't want to over exaggerate. I saw four different counselors, and they were all Robert to me. And I had this script in mind, and I would do the exact same Parker thing, to where I would repeat the lines and everything, and I would write down mentally what the counselors were saying, and that became the script of what Robert would say. And some people are like, oh, the looking at this scene and it doesn't work. So it took a couple of nights, and Rachel's just, you know, hammering down on this fake mannequin. Blood's going everywhere. By the way, this house is my house. So blood is just splattering out from the cabinets and everything. 2 months ago was the last time that I saw the last bit of blood from Parker Sessions, and that was 2.5 years ago. But it took 2 nights to do that, 2 shoots, so 2 cleanups of that. But it was worth it now. It was worth it, you know.
It was very good. What did you guys think about that head?
I'm a vegetarian. My makeup person was like, I went, and she's vegan. I'm vegetarian, she's vegan. She's like, I went and grabbed these bone chicken wings, and I'm gonna take out the flesh and everything. I'm gonna take the bone and put it in the blood, and then we're gonna slop that around. That does not show up on film. So if you're making a film, just don't do that.